Okay, so welcome to my podcast. Normally, if I had a keyboard, I haven't got a keyboard with me at the moment, but I would do some kind of like, oh God, I'm rocking the double chin here today. It's the angle. but yeah, normally I would do some like theme music, but obviously I've not got my keyboard with me. But this is my first ever episode, Jake. So how honoured do you feel?
You know what? I couldn't sleep last night. Super excited.
Oh, right. Okay. Sorry.
Honestly, man, it's an absolute privilege. I think this is a great idea. This is great. I love it.
I mean, I've been wanting to do it for a while because I don't know. So firstly, I want to introduce you to everybody. So this is Jake Gosling. He is best known for his ballet career at the early age of...
What? I mean,
so tell us about that. So you used to be a ballet dancer, right?
Well, how did you know that? That is weird. I did. I mean, I wouldn't say I was professional. In my head, I thought I was. But in theory, no. Like when I was a kid, my mum was like, I think you should try all the different stuff. My mum's a bit of a hippie. So she's you got to try this and do that and all that sort of stuff. So I was like, suddenly next thing I know, I'm doing ballet. But you know what, Billy? I was pretty good.
You know what? You've got the body for it. You really have. You know, when I found out, I was like, of course. You know, it's a no-brainer.
It was an obvious one. You're like, this is definitely something I would do.
The unusual thing is, I guess it's quite a strange thing to go from ballet to music production. Is that a normal is that a normal route? Because I haven't met many.
I mean, I was only a kid, and it was like, you know, it was just sort of like when I was like 9 or 10 or something like that.
Yeah.
But it was quite fun. I mean, I actually really enjoyed it. I mean, it was like, I did tap as well. Just throwing it in there.
Tap
dancing. Yeah.
Weirdly, that's quite similar to music because it it is a kind of it's a form of drums, I would say.
Yeah, no, you're right. I mean, I think you're tapping away. You're doing all the sort of beat rhythms and the
you've got to have timing. Do you know what? Weirdly, actually, I'm terrible at dancing. I've never, ever been able to do it. And Kirsten's been trying to teach me for years. And that's quite unusual, isn't it? To be good at music, but not... Well, maybe I'm not good at music. Maybe that's a sign. but it's quite unusual. Like, I've got absolutely no rhythm and I can't move my body in any way.
Right.
But when it comes to actually playing music, time is pretty good. It's quite odd.
Yeah, really. No, it is. It's a weird one. I think, when you're playing an instrument or something, you know what I mean? It's the musicality is all there, especially when you're playing piano and singing. I mean, to do that is a real skill, to be able to sing a melody and play rhythm in a different way of a piano. I mean, that takes a lot of skill. But dancing's a different type of thing, isn't it? And I think half of it's actually about confidence.
Hang on a minute. You're saying you're a good dancer because we've been out. You know, we've been out many a times. I mean, I'm trying to think. The first. Where did we meet? I swear.
We met at a party. We met at a Warner party.
No? You think we met at Brit Awards, right? Do you remember that?
I do.
We met at Brit Awards, and then I remembered that we actually met about a couple years before that. Do you not remember?
Right. Where? No.
Because I was a kid, right, and I'd just done a gig, and you were quite a big time producer, right? And I came over, and I sort of said, "Hey, I'm Billy Lockett. Here's my CD. I'd love if you could listen to it."
Yes, it's all flooding back to me now.
And you said nothing.
What an asshole I am! Really? So I literally just took the CD, just said nothing, just went. Oh. My God, you must have caught me off guard, I think.
What was the CD like? Did you enjoy it?
It was amazing. Well, you know, your early works, Billy Lockett's early works, the masterpieces, yeah.
But no, I guess we started to become friends after that and we worked together. It's weird, we've written quite a few songs together, but the strange thing is we've written about 6 now, haven't we? And every single one is really, really good. And I've not released any of them.
This was my next question. But, you know, I think it's weird. I think with songs and stuff like that, I don't know how you find it, but you write and you write and you write. I mean, you must have thousands, but, you know, yeah. And you just forget about them. And then they're sort of there. And then it's not till sometimes you go back, you listen, you go, that's a banger, you know, but you sort of forget because you do so many. And half the time you're in the moment, aren't you? And you're moving on to new things. And that's naturally what happens. Not always that they're not good. You just sort of put them in the vault and they sort of stay there until some time. But I have had it when I've written tracks and literally 3 or 4 years later that suddenly you get a call or something and go, that song, we love it. It's gonna come out or something. But
that's the thing, isn't it? I've been recently getting over the whole idea of, oh, the song is old, therefore it's not as good. You know, because that is such a big thing in a lot of people's mind, like a lot of artists, producers' minds. It's kind of like, you know, because I get it because I guess you're thinking back and going, oh, well, I wasn't as good back then. And so I've learned all of these new things that make me technically better. But I guess that's the thing with music, isn't it? You know, sometimes the naivety can be the magic. I almost think I almost know too much about how to write a song now. And I've created all of these like weird like barriers of like, can't, you know, the chorus has got to come in before a minute and I've got to make sure that it's about this and it's got to have this, you know, and it's kind of have an intro because of Spotify and all these things.
Sure.
It kind of changed. Does that change the way that you produce now, the way like Spotify and how quick it needs to be?
No, I mean, I try not to let it determine the way I write, but I mean, it you know, it's difficult because, you know, the way people are listening to music, it's songs seem to be getting shorter and shorter. You know, it's like 2 minutes is enough sometimes. But there's something to be said about making sure you can fit, you know, not every song should be like that. But I think that there is, if you can, I mean, the hardest thing in the world is to write something that really communicates straight away and you can say everything you need to say. And if the limit of time is shorter, if it's only 2 minutes, then I guess that's a super skill because you need to be able to communicate that in a very short period of time to not lose the attention of what people is. I guess if it's more of a, you know, instantaneous thing. But then there are some songs that you don't want that and you want to be able to create a journey and for people to sort of experience in a different way. But I guess that's the difference between, you know, I guess, a commercial track that, you know, you want to sort of hit straight away or something where people can listen to it, you know, in a different way. But, you know, the way people listen to music on Spotify now is so different. I mean, I'll put on like, you know, lo-fi chill out beats, you know, with no melody or lyrics, you know what I mean, just so I can not listen to anything else and just it's just there. Someone's making a fortune out of it, but you know, maybe that's my new direction.
I do exactly the same thing. I listen to lo-fi beats,
yeah, lo-fi chill out
nothing
beat.
Or like I mean, that's why I love Iron Aldi so much, because it's kind of, you know, there's no lyrics and but maybe that's just because, you know, we spend our lives making music and listening to constantly melodies and words and having to work out things. So, but I mean, for me personally, I don't even really listen to that much music these days.
Yeah.
Because I'm doing it all day and I'm writing all day. But by the time it gets to six, I don't really want to listen to anything. I just want to, maybe a podcast, you know, that I think that's the thing. I probably listen to podcasts more than anything else at the moment, which is strange, because the whole concept of this, like two people talking, and that's interesting. It's basically like I listened to a lot of Joe Rogan, and he was saying, you know, like the idea that you're just going to have any guest on, and there's not going to be any theme whatsoever, and you can talk for as long as you want about whatever you want. I mean, it's like it's a PR nightmare, really, isn't it? But weirdly. Weirdly, it's sort of taken the world by storm, and it's created this whole new way of doing things. And it's almost as successful as music now, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I do the same thing. I mean, I'll, you know, sit on the lawnmower and
sit on the lawnmower. Is that a metaphor? Is it?
It's a metaphor for a new song. But yeah, and then just have the, you know, just have the podcast on and just literally drive around the garden and just sort of listen to this stuff. But, you know,
do you know what's interesting, actually? What you were saying earlier about how songs are getting shorter and shorter. Mm. I mean, I totally agree with that. But what is also interesting is that, like, shows, say, like, you know, TV and shows, they're getting longer, which is quite interesting. You know, like Netflix, it used to be, it was all about movies. All the movie stars were in movies. And now it's all about, you know, people just want more and more and more. They want to binge, you know, and it's Why do you think it is that that hasn't related to music?
I think it still does, but I think it's just, you know, obviously we're all sort of promoted to all the time by, I guess, everything you see is marketing in terms of, you know, pop music. So it's, you know, what the playlist. I mean, Spotify is basically, you know, a massive sort of machine where, you know, especially for new artists, you know, it's really difficult. You know that there's this sort of thing, oh, anyone can release music, and you can, but to be heard on it and to actually get on a playlist, which is what people want, is pretty difficult.
It is.
And that's really because a lot of, you know, the major record companies sort of own Spotify, so they determine with their new artists that it will be on every single playlist, because they'll just phone up the guy at Spotify and say, hold on a second, my new artist, blah, blah.
Yeah.
He's got their single out. Why is it not on New Music Friday? Or why is it not on this? Because, you know, and it's a shame.
Sorry to interrupt there, but could you argue that that kind of sort of hierarchy politics has kind of been the same forever? It's just, you know, the things are changing. So it used to be radio and now it's Spotify. And before that, I guess it was TV, you know. Is it the same, do you think?
I think it's sort of the same, but I mean, radio is slightly different because Radio 1, for example, is an independent. So, you know, in order for you, you know, I think that the tastemakers and the people at Radio 1 tend to be more driven around, you know, actually finding new music. I mean, there are some real champions of... and also local radio, BBC introducing and stuff like that, because they're not tied in, they're not like commercialized, there's no advertising involved. So for them, there's no gain in really sort of like, you can't buy necessarily a place, you know, on Radio 1, or you can't really buy, you know, into BBC introducing. It's more about them find. So I think it has changed in terms of the Spotify's of this world, because obviously it's a commercial animal.
That's sort of
the way it is. But I mean, you know, you do get successes through it. I mean, you know, I mean, TikTok is obviously a massive thing, and music on that's even shorter. I mean, we're talking, 15 seconds long. You know, it's like, hold on a second. You know, if you're a songwriter, you're like,
one day a songwriter is just going to be like, literally,
more than likely, yeah.
An album's going to be like, maybe I should do that. I should do an album that's 12 seconds long. We should make a 12-second long album.
There you go.
And we'll only make one copy, right?
Yeah.
And we'll just do it on cassette, right?
There you go.
And sell it for a fortune. Just da.
I know. It's crazy. It's crazy. It really is, man. But, you know,
So if you, let's sort of rewind a bit, because obviously some people that are watching this probably might not know who you are. And so you're a music producer, and how long have you been doing this for?
I've been doing this for a long time, pretty much. You know, I was started as a songwriter, so the production stuff sort of came later.
Really?
Okay. Yeah. So it was like I wrote my first song when I was like 9 or 10, after the ballet moment.
Do you know what? I've got an interesting fact, actually.
Right.
Apparently, you wrote a musical when you were 14 called Thomas Harper, right?
Where are you getting this information?
And it was absolutely loved by Tim Rice, who I actually shamefully don't actually know who that is. Andrew Lloyd Webber, who I do know who that is.
Yeah.
And you also won a competition, and you got to perform it at the Barbican. Is that one of your most proud moments?
I mean, it was like, you know, it was a pretty proud moment. I mean, it was quite an ambitious project. And I went to the school and I was like, I want to put on a musical and I want to write the music to it and write this. You know, I teamed up with another guy at school. I asked a couple of mates and they thought I was bonkers. And they were like, mate, what are you talking about? I'm 13. I just want to go and kick the ball around.
prancing around in your
I was prancing around in my
to do a musical.
Yeah, exactly. What's wrong with me? But it sort of came together, and the school liked it because it was all about sort of the Civil War, and it was the Roundheads and the Cavaliers and all that. And the school loved it. So, and you know, I auditioned the school, you know, the people in the school were in it, and we put it on there. And I entered this competition, which was for young musical writers sort of around the UK. And the people on the panel were like Don Black. You probably won't know any of these people, but they're massive in the musical world. So right. Andrew Lloyd Webber obviously has Cats, and he's, you know, one of the biggest sort of, you know, guys out there sort of in that world. Tim Rice. Tim Rice was also involved with him and did Evita, which was the big sort of Madonna-y film and stuff as well. But again, a big musical guy. And I put this thing in with this guy, and we got into the sort of finals of it, and and got through, and it was aired on BBC Radio 2 at the time, and you know, it was amazing. I mean, they didn't perform the whole thing at the Barbican; they just performed like, I think it was like three songs and three different scenes, because obviously it was a massive undertaking to do. But yeah, man, it was exciting. But after then, I was like, right, you know, I was like, it was around, you know, GCSEs before then. And then I got into bands. And then I was, right. you know, sort of started singing and playing, and I'd been writing anyway. And then that became my new love. And I took
well, this is the thing. So you, because do you think there's anyone, I don't know whether I've met anyone who is a songwriter or a producer who started at the age of like 15, 16 going, right, I want to be a songwriter and a producer. It's almost like everybody was like, I want to be an artist. Mm. And then they go down that sort of
yeah, avenue. I think it's pretty common. I think that you normally start, I mean, you now produce and you obviously, yeah. you've always written, but you know, because, and you're an artist foremost, but you know, you build up these skills naturally because, you know, you sort of do. And the production, like I said, came a bit later. And I think you're right. I think the majority of producers, you know, or songwriters have started being artists or trying to be. I thought I'd be in a cool band and, you know, be hanging out, you know, in Manchester, sort of, you know, in my indie yeah. days. But, you know, it didn't quite work out. It was, you
well,
know,
I
it's
guess
one of those
you produced
things.
Libertines. Do you know what I mean? That was yeah. as close as you
oh,
could get.
Oh, man, that was, yeah, that was amazing. That was amazing, you know. But, and obviously loving indie music, and I was fans. So it was like, yeah. Do you want to... You know, I met Carl and I was like, you know, had a meeting with him, and it was obviously it's all relationship based, and we had to go and record it out in Thailand, and yeah. We were going to live together.
Had to. You had yeah. to go out. Oh,
well, we had to, yeah. Well, because Pete was in rehab at the time out there and stuff. So it made sense to try and, you know, because of him, he's such a creative, you know, soul, and yeah, you know, yeah. he, you know, it was helpful that he was sort of in that environment, you know, for his mind as well as anything else. And the band, you know, everyone being together at one spot rather than London, it could have been yeah. a bit tricky because there's too many distractions, you know.
Do you think being in Thailand helped it?
Oh, 100%.
Really?
100%, because, you know, you've got that focus. I think, you know, I've always loved working on albums as an entirety. I've always tends to be my main theme, where I've invested in an artist and work with them throughout a project, rather than I'm not really a guy that you go to, I don't think, and go, I want a fucking number one single. If, you yeah. know, it's like, I tend to be more about developing, and I guess that's the sort of, you know, getting a broad brushstroke and understanding of what the artist wants to do, rather than sort of just fling paint at it and just go, blah, blah, blah. You know, I can do that, but I prefer the relationship. I prefer the whole journey of what, you know, a piece yeah. of work can be. You know, it's like your dad being an artist. It's like that sort of immersive thing of, you know, and you've got the same thing, you know.
I think it does help when you're making an album that you do it all in one go, just because of that consistency. Because I think for me, a lot of the problem when I was with the label was I was doing writing a different song with a different producer every day, you know, and so there was no consistency. And I guess the idea is that you write all of these different songs and they are all completely different sounds, because that's probably what you... So an artist would come to you and be like, right, I want to do an album. I've got 12 songs. They've all been produced by random different people. And then your job is to basically go, okay, how do we get all of these 12 to sound the same in a way?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Well, I'd
not be influenced by any of the yeah. any of the production that's going on, because it will all be different.
Well, this is it. I mean, you know, everyone works differently, you know, and everyone's got, I'd say everyone works differently. Not a lot. I mean, there are a lot of people that tend to sort of copy a lot. So they tend to, you know, when I say copy, that they'll sort of, that they'll like, I don't know, listen to what's the latest thing and try and like do that. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Whereas
yeah.
for me, I'd prefer to sort of not do that as such and try and reach in different areas and pull from different things. You're obviously always influenced, but there's a difference between sort of you know, I guess I think you have to still keep that experiment, you know, experimenting going as you make the record. And when you're doing an album, for example, you need to be able to create in that way, I think. But yeah, I mean, it's different.
I mean, for me, producing, really, the only reason I kind of learned how to produce was to, because I was kind of annoyed of not being able to just get it done. Do you know what I mean? Like, every time I had a sound in my head, I'd kind of have to wait for a producer to kind of like be free and then go and do it. And so I can, that kind of helped. But the problem I have now that I can produce is that with EPs, I used to go in and do that exact thing that you're talking about, where you go in and you make the record and you've booked out 2 weeks with a producer of all these songs. Whereas now that I can produce at home, it takes me, you know, it's taking me, I think it's going to take me about a year to do these 12 songs for the album.
Mm.
And, you know, I'm coming back to them. And there is that beauty of being able to go, okay, you know what, I'm going to park that for a week or so, come back to it, pick at it. But the problem is, obviously, you have 12 songs that probably sound different for that exact same problem, that you're not in that rigid week after week doing it. You know, so I don't know whether sometimes I'm like, oh, God, is it going to affect my creativity, the fact that I know how to produce? You know what I mean?
No, of course it does. I mean, you know, the it's very common, you know, to double, triple, sort of go round in circles a bit with A, the song, the writing, or the song itself, and also the production. And you can create a sound on, you know, you can make a production in any way you want. I mean, that's why, you know, obviously with Dua Lipa recently, she did like almost three different versions of her record, you know, by...
Really?
Yeah. And then you've got remixes, obviously, that's always been done. So you've got like, you know, another version of the song, and that's, you know, that dance
is
remix.
That, is that because she couldn't make her mind up, or is that because she wanted to show every, well, probably a bit of both, I guess, isn't it? But I guess it's that you want to show everyone all these different journeys.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, you know, it's like Taylor Swift, you know, you know, going back to her work, and, you know, you could say cynically, well, you know, she's doing it because she's, you know, cashing back in those songs. But at the same time, you know, there's something nice about listening to the same song in a different way. And I think that's smart. You know, I think that, you know, you might love one version of Taylor's track, but you might prefer the other one more because it's done in a different way. So, you know, music,
that's the thing, isn't it? It's subjective, isn't it?
It's so subjective. And I think that's important. What I like, you might not like, you know, and I think that's good. I think it's good to have that, you know.
I think sometimes in my head, when I've thought about, because I've got this song that's been driving me mad, and I mean I've talked about it a lot online, and I'm on like version 12D, know that kind of situation, you know? And I've tried it as a ballad, I've tried it as a full band, I've tried it with synths, and then the verse is a chorus, no, the chorus is a verse, this is all this, the classic round the houses. And then I think, oh, okay, why don't I just release all the versions? But then there's a voice in my head going, yeah, but one of those is the best, and you want to release the best.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Even though music is subjective, sometimes there is a spectrum, isn't there? And you kind of think, oh, well, yeah, but what is the most, what's the one that most people, and what, you know, most people will love? You know, there is that thing of, music is objective, but sometimes it is just bad.
Well, I think there is that as well. But, you know, then again, I mean, radio stations vary so much. I mean, you know, Radio 6, I'm a big fan of. But, you know, sometimes I listen to stuff on there and I'm like, really? I'm like, how? What? You know what I mean? Because it's so out there in a way. I'm like, is this really? But, you know, but I guess that's the point of it. You know, it's supposed to challenge you and it's supposed to push you. You know, it's like, it's like art. It's like anything. And it should do. And it should create a feeling. And you should have a reaction to it. In a sense. But yeah, I mean, good or bad, I mean, it's, I guess that's just, like you say, subjective, and, you know, it's your opinion of what it is. But
well, it's also that thing of like, you know, Kirsten was listening to some music the other day, I don't know what it was, but I sort of came up and I was like, what's this? And she told me the name, I can't remember what the name was, but I was like, oh, I'm not really sure about this. And she kind of said to me, well, it's not for you.
It's not for you. Right.
Fair enough. You know, it kind of made sense. And I was like, yeah, you're right, actually. Like, how dare I? And I didn't make a fuss of it, but I was, and I guess that's the thing, isn't it? It's hard. I mean, obviously now, you know, you're not an artist. So when you're a producer now, I guess, right? So when someone says, oh, I'm not really into something you've made, is it, so say you play it to Nukes, right? And she's just not into it. Does it hit you the same way that if I, you know, if it was your own song? Because even though you're producing it, do you still feel that kind of...
Well, I think, to be fair, I'm always working alongside the artist. So it's not like I'm sort of going completely off the radar and work. Yeah. I don't work like that. I mean, my role is to sort of understand what the song's about and get into the head of the artist and try and get their vision of what they feel or where it should go. And I think that can be quite difficult, because how do you describe music, you know, without playing a note or singing something? But, you know, my role is to sort of really get under the skin of it and try and make it come to life and hopefully get it right for the artist. But not only that, try and make it communicate, you know, and try and make it, on the ears, things, you know, whatever it might be. And everyone's got their own style to do it. And every artist is different. A Libertines record is completely different to, you know, a Shania Twain record. You know what I mean? There's completely different other ends of the spectrum.
Well, this is the interesting thing, isn't it? That when I was sort of like researching you and sort of trying to work out, you know, where I found all the ballet things.
where is this?
It's weird because we've been friends for quite a long time now, but I had never noticed how different the artists that you work on are. You know, because it was kind of like, oh my God, this is crazy. Like Ed Sheeran, One Direction, then the Libertines and Shania Twain, and you're just thinking, because normally producers would have that, you know, an A&R would go, ah, we want this sound. Yeah. I know who we should use, that guy.
Yeah.
You know, and has that been intentional for you to try not to, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, it's been completely intentional. My dad did music, and he was really frustrated because, you know, he was in bands and he was in the whole sort of, you know, 70s sort of jazz, fusion, funk, soul, you know, blues sort of thing. And they had, you know, it was some mad sort of 70s crazy thing. And he was a singer in that and he loved it. And, you know, it was that whole sort of free, you know, do whatever. And then he, funnily enough, got into sort of doing like jingles and advertising music and stuff, which he ended up doing. And what he found was that he got really, he called, you know, being pigeonholed. And I think it's a real common thing in everyone's life where, you know, you feel like people are trying to put you in some sort of box. People are trying to say, right, Billy, Jake, you know, whoever it is, you know, this is, you know, you're only known really for what people know of you know, someone saying it or media or whatever it might be. So then that's when the pigeonhole comes in. It's like, for example, if you were going to suddenly release a, you know, rap record, you know, I mean,
don't tell everyone.
No. Oh my God. Sorry. exclusive. Then people might be raise their eyebrows a bit and go, that's not going to da da da. And sometimes,
but I guess, don't you think that people would potentially put themselves into those boxes, like, because they think that it might make it more accessible for the people who already like it? You know, there is that thing.
Yeah, listen, I think it's very different for an artist compared to a producer. Like, for me, I'm, you know, for someone like, you know, it's like a James Bay situation. Like, I loved his first record. Like, when I worked with him on that, and, you know, it was like, when he was in that zone, it was just like, this is sick. This is, like, really connecting. He's a great writer. He had the hat, he's got the hair, he just looks the part. He's a dude, you know, he can play, he can sing. I'm like, you know, he's got it, it's there. The album did amazingly well. First album went crazy. And then when it came to second album, it was a whole different story for him. And I think that he tried...
He lost the hat, though, didn't
he? He lost the hat and he cut his hair and he put on sparkly clothes. And I think, unfortunately, you know, I take my hat off to him. boom, boom. But, you know, and, you know, but I think that you know, it's a shame that, you know, that in a way, you know, his second album didn't communicate in that way, because it was so different to his first record that that people didn't really understand it. And it can be really difficult for artists. But for me as a producer, it's I'm forever adapting. I'm forever moving. I have to keep learning, and I have to keep seeing what's new and fresh. And like, and those are the things that excite me, because a new artist and what's happening on the ground and under the ground and like in bits and pockets and things are popping off everywhere all the time. And I have to keep alert to it because it's exciting. I love it. And I think as long as you enjoy it, you love it, then that's fine. But I'm always adapting. Like at the moment, I'm working a lot with drill artists, which I've gone back to, like, you know, the sort of early things when I worked with Wiley and sort of in the rap sort of world, because I love it, because it's a whole nother thing again. It's, you know, it's popping off in Brighton. There's this guy called Ardy, 17 years old, you know, did one freestyle and it's just gone absolutely mental on, really, you know, without a record label. These guys are doing it without labels, you know. Central C, top 10, no label. Digger D, same story, top 10. And I'm working with these guys and I'm like, this is exciting. This is, and there's no big man. There's no like machine, as it were. And okay, I'm not a drill producer, but then I can collaborate and bring in other guys who have been brought up on that, and then we can all create something new again, another genre within that. And you just keep, you know, you keep trying, experimenting, and collaboration is huge. You know, I didn't realize how big collaboration is and how important it is as well.
Songwriting
as well.
I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? We are just going back to that point of you saying, you know, people are making it without labels and things. It's interesting. Do you think this is, even though we do criticise Spotify sometimes and just in general streaming, it has, the internet and streaming has given people like me and people, well, all over the country, all over the world, careers that do well without any kind of real machine as such.
Sure.
Do you reckon this is probably the first time that's ever happened in the history of music?
No, definitely not. I mean, I think that there's, I mean, if you, I mean, obviously the you know, streaming and that wasn't there before, but I think people, there's always been independence. There always will be indie people. There'll always be people doing it on, you know, on their own.
Sure, but they would, but I guess before it was a case of, okay, well, if you haven't got a label, you haven't got enough money to get it in the shops, you know, and if you're not in the shops, that's it. I think this is the thing. You can literally make a song, and within, by the next day, you can upload it to Spotify and it can get a playlist, and all of a sudden you're earning a living from music. It's like, that's a pretty mental world that we're living in now, isn't it? Obviously, I know that, you know, labels do still hold certain levels of power in situations, but, I mean, Bruno Major actually posted something a few weeks ago. I don't know if you saw this, but it was kind of like, it was an article about Spotify and how the, major labels are only... only own 70%. No,
only 80%. I know.
Yeah, and the thing is, right, I know this. I know this sounds bad, right? That they own 80% of all this, all of the income from music. But 3 years ago, they owned 92%, and they're saying that in 10 years' time, they're going to own less than 50%. If we keep going the way we're going. They had all these graphs. I mean, I don't know the actual proper information.
Sure.
But basically what it was saying was that major labels are losing an element of power.
Yeah.
Which I agree with.
I don't know if that's true necessarily, but I think that, you know, I mean, it would be wonderful to think that, you know, the artists and songwriters and the people that really, really make the work. It's just the weirdest world where the people that spend, you know, their lives, you know, thrashing away, making it and creating it and doing it. I mean, you know, I'm sure a lot of people, because it's music, you know, a lot of people don't understand it and they think, oh, it's, you know, it's not really a job. And I guess to a point, it's not really a job in that sense, but it is, because it's an entertainment thing. And it's like going, well, it's, you know, if you compare it to, I love that song, you know, and it's something that, you know, I meet people all the time and they're like, that's changed my life, or that reminds me of these amazing moments, or whatever it is. And it's a moment in your life. It could be a wedding. It could be a, you know, unfortunate things like funerals or whatever it might be. But things that can touch you and move you.
It's kind of needed, isn't it?
It is needed. It is really needed. Imagine a world without it. I mean, imagine a world without music. It would be a very sad place. And it is tough. Yeah. And there are a lot of people out there I know, especially now there's a massive campaign. I'm part of the Ivers Academy and we're really, really pushing, you know, for songwriters, especially in the industry to actually try and make some money because the royalty rate is so bad. It's worse than the minimum wage. And these poor people who have been doing it, who used to earn a living and have children and families and and do all this hard work and, you know.
That's basically because someone tried to explain this to me. So is it because the labels got in there before the publishers when it came to streaming? Is that what happened? Is that what happened?
No, I mean, it's a combination of a few things. The problem is there's been lots of problems with the music industry as industry for a long time. And, you know, it's the only one that is so backward in so many ways. A lot of people in the business world, if they're running a business, they'd look at the music industry and go, this is just, what is this? It doesn't make any sense.
Do you know what?
You know,
I've been doing quite a few like funny TikToks. I
know. Do you know what? They are absolutely brilliant. Please keep doing them. Because honestly, they just make me crack up.
This is a thing. I was thinking of you actually, because I always just think about like so many, because I've been in this industry for so long now, and there's just so many things that have happened in my life where I've kind of gone, oh, okay, is that, that's weird, but I guess that's how it is, you know, and then I've always struggled myself, and then I did this one video about PR companies, and it went off, and Jason Derulo was like, sent me messages,
I saw it,
but she loved it, and I was just thinking, oh my God, if people like that, I've got a whole load of these, man.
Keep them coming. Because, I mean, honestly, what you're doing is, I know you're making light of it, and that's the best thing about it, because that's the only way for us to get around it. But it's all true. And I think it's so funny, the fact that it's so true. And it, people are like, what? You know, so I have to pay to play tonight. You know what I mean? Or you know, the PR guy that, you know, says, I can't guarantee anything at all. But, you know, I might be able to get, you know, you on radio, but I can't guarantee it. But just give us $4,000 and we'll see what happens. You know, I mean, I've been there. I've been there myself so many times. I mean, I've seen it and it's all true. It's all true. I mean, listen, don't get me wrong. There are some brilliant people out there. And they're, you know, but it's finding them. It's very hard. You know, if there's any good ones out there, please let us know. Because they'll be hired regularly. But that's probably it. That, you know, they're probably just, you know, they've all got too much on.
I mean, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Because you know, we moan about it so much, but we're still doing it.
Yeah, I know.
And we've got pretty good lives.
Listen, man, it ain't that bad. It's not that bad.
Well, that's the thing.
We're very lucky and we're really blessed. And I'm, you know, I really am. And it's like, you know, it's, you know, yeah, you know, you can moan and complain about this and the other, but, you know, I think, you know, listening to your music, you know, when I heard your new EP and stuff, and I was like, this is just, it's great. And it's better than great because it's you and it's just all you. And it's songs that you weren't able to, you know, to put out. And now you're free in that respect and you can put out your music and you can put it out when you want to.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? That's the beauty of being independent.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, sometimes I do think, oh, you know what, maybe I should sort of, because like we've always talked to labels and they've obviously, because this record went top 10 and we've had a lot of interest, and you know, I'm not against labels at all.
No.
I think a lot of people think that I am against record labels, but that's kind of like saying I'm against people.
Yeah.
You know, everyone's different. Yeah. And I think when I call it the label, you know, it was a few people that, you know, I couldn't work with.
Mm.
You know, they weren't bad people, but I couldn't work with. And I think the problem with being signed is that you're not really in charge of the team you get. You're kind of like someone sort of just employed to go, okay, hey, you know, this is the artist you're working with. And as we go back, you know, music is subjective. And, you know, Kirsten works at a record label. And sometimes I say to her, like, what if you don't like the band that you've been... I mean, luckily she likes them all. But, you know, what do you do then? You've got to spend your whole life... I mean, I felt bad for my label in a way because maybe they didn't really get it, and they were forced to work on it all the time, and that must have been tough.
I mean, that definitely happens. I mean, you know, I was a record plugger for a bit, and you know, I was terrible, Billy. I was awful. I mean, I was like, it was regional.
I'm going to do a video about that soon. Yeah,
it was regional radio, and I remember sort of phoning up these, you know, Dragon FM and going in Wales, going like, so you're going to play? I mean, you know, it's just, I don't know. Jimmy Nail or whatever the hell it was. And I was, no one probably knows who Jimmy Nail is now anyway. But anyway, it was, they were quite big artists then. And they were like, I was like, are you going to play this? And they're like, yeah. And I was like, do you like it? They're like, well, not really. I was like, well, why are you going to play it? I'm like, this didn't make any sense.
What?
Why are you playing? Well, because we're part of, you know, this big group that because it's officially on that list. And, you know, this is what we think people need to hear. And I'm like, really? But what? You think they need to hear it, but you personally don't like it. Okay, that makes no sense. But yeah, I mean, it
so wait a minute, but your job was to get them on the
My
radio.
My job was to get them on the radio. That's why I was so bad. But I mean, you know, but in that case, it was easy because they were like, yeah, we'll put it on. But it wasn't the case you know, all the time. But yeah.
I do understand it. Yeah, I mean, you know, it must be difficult. But I guess, you know, that is the beauty of when an artist, producer and label all just gets on, you know, and everything just works. And I guess those are the records that, well, I get, there is no rules to it. You know, when I was signed, most of my friends who were signed, it was very unusual if we all met up and went, how's your label? Oh, I love my label. They're great. Mm. You know, that never really seemed to be the case. It was always like, yeah, it's okay, we're trying to do this, they're fighting back on this. And it's kind of interesting because it must be really sad when everything's amazing, the label's great, it sounds amazing, and the record just flops. Because then it's just like,
I mean, the thing is, a lot, there's so much to do with, you know, they always say it's timing, it's place, it's, you know, the universe, everything's aligning and da-da-da. And, you know, there is something to be said about timing, you know, in terms of...
Would you say that now you've done it for so long, you have a good idea of when something's going to work? Like when you're making an album and you feel it, chances are, does it work?
I never go into anything with an expectation of it going, this is going to be the next biggest thing at all, because otherwise I think you drive yourself crazy. I think you just have to, I'll always choose projects or collaborate and work with people that I genuinely really have, you know, a strong feeling about, obviously, you know. But I haven't always worked on records just for the sake of it. And I've turned down a lot of records, just, you know, even when there has been so-called, you know, I guess, you know, big artists, you know, who are, you know, maybe mainstream and really well known. But I've thought, well, this isn't for me. You know, I don't feel like I'm going to enjoy it, because life is short and you've got to really sort of, you know, you've got to enjoy the stuff you work on and enjoy the process. Otherwise, you'll just be beating your head against the wall. No matter what you do, no matter what job, I know you've got to try really hard to just take those risks a bit and to try and do things you love doing and try and get through it. I'm fortunate enough to be able to have some successes in music. So, you know, but before then I didn't. So it was terrifying. I literally was terrified.
Well, this is the thing, isn't it? I guess there must have been a point where, you know, because everyone has that moment when, okay, thank God I've got that name under my belt. It's like, now I've got a career.
Yeah.
You know, for me, I was releasing song after song and it wasn't working. And then I got one that sort of gave me, you know, some stability, I guess. I remember vaguely you telling me that, you know, so I'm assuming your first big thing was Ed Sheeran, right?
It was sort of like big things before then, but not as big as obviously Ed went ridiculous. But I guess the first sort of thing was Wiley, really. I mean, that was sort of the main thing that really sort of popped off. And obviously then it was sort of Ed. And I'd done little, you know, bits here and there, but, you know.
And how old were you when when it all started to kick off?
I mean, I can't remember.
Well, this is another thing, actually. I wanted to ask you. We're sort of coming towards the end, but I just wanted to ask you this. This might be quite interesting for people watching. Do you feel that you've made it?
That's an interesting one. I sort of yes and no. I mean, it's like I'm so proud of what, you know, you know, Ed's done and that one, that was a very unique thing to sort of be part of that journey and to see that happen from nothing to like crazy stuff. So in that respect, you know, I am super like blown away by that. And it was actually a bit of a mind fuck because you're like, what the hell? You know, it's, you know, from nothing to that was quite astounding to see it all develop. And it was like a roller coaster ride. It was like, buckle up, here we go. You know, it was like every week, every month, everything was popping off around the world. It was da da da. But I wake up still now every day and I'm like, I'm still searching for other things all the time. I'm still excited about new music and I'm pretty sure that will keep going. And it's important for me to keep relevant as well, because that people will be like, okay, great. You know, and you know what people are like, they can be cynical and again, pigeonholing and stuff like that. And they can be like, okay, great. Well, you know, nice one, Jake, but here's the next lot or here's the new. And that always happens anyway. It's part of life.
The thing, I guess you need that feeling, don't you? You don't ever want to really feel like you've made it, because you want to, you know, then you'll probably stop progressing, I guess, wouldn't you? You'd probably stop pushing forwards if you think, oh, I'm there.
Yeah, no, I think it's the same for everyone. I know for anyone, you know, you have to keep striving stuff and you have to keep, you know, that energy up. Same for you, you know, that every EP you do, every new song, you know, you do that and then you're like, that's that bit. And then you work towards the next bit. I need to put power, I need to put power in my phone because it's going to cut out.
Really? Okay.
I'm going to suddenly be a black screen.
No problem.
Hold on, Greg.
I'd just be mid-flow and you're just gone.
My headphones are coming out. Hold on one sec. I'm just gonna... There we go.
Anyway, we're sort of drawing to an end anyway. One thing, I don't know whether you had time to do this.
Yeah.
But one of my little features on this podcast is a treat for Trevor.
Ah, okay. Great. I think I might have something.
Oh, okay. Great. Good.
I have two treats for Trevor. Because I thought, being your first podcast person, that I'd up the ante and go for two. So, I mean, they're nothing special, but I got him this.
Whoa, what is that?
This is a dog.
Oh, it's literally a treat.
It's a dog. It's literally a dog treat.
Well, you're so creative, Jake.
I know, thanks. Really, no. And then I got another treat, which is this. Now, it's not what you think it is. Not a hat. It's a Kong. It's a treat ball. So you put treats in here as well.
Oh, yeah.
And then you can... So I'll send it up to you and you can...
So what is it? Like what? Like a game?
It's called a Kong. So you put little treats in this thingy and then he chases it around like a nutter. And then the treats, he'll try and eat them because he'll smell it inside. So there you go.
Oh, wow.
There's for Trevor.
What, and you ran out and bought those, did you?
Of course I did. Of course I did, mate. You know what I mean? What do you think I am? I'm not a cheapskate.
Great. Well, thank you for talking to me.
Oh, dude, absolute pleasure, man. And listen, the podcast is awesome. Keep it going. I can't wait to tune into your next one.
Yeah, man. I'm going to be announcing my next one next week. Thank you to everyone who's tuned in. I know my mum sent a lot of comments. I think she's been drinking again.
Oh, bless her. I love your mum.
Yeah, she is great, isn't she? I haven't really seen her much, actually, obviously, because of COVID and things. But she's always supported me a lot. So, and also, so have you, man. I'm really, really grateful. You know, you've always been there through the whole label mess and everything.
I'm always there for you. Always love, man. Always love.
I'm really grateful. I hope everyone enjoyed this. And tune in next time for another episode of Reflections with Billy. We're supposed to wave and run out, but we leave our camera there, so we run away.
We run off.
Yeah, no, we won't. We'll just end it. But imagine that's what we've done, everyone.
Okay, great.
Well, cheers, guys. Cheers, Jake.
Brilliant, man. Take it easy. See you soon.
See you in a bit. All right, how do we end this now?